So, if you remember from earlier in the class, we've been showing this example of face recognition over and over to demonstrate how using a subspace to model a collection of faces in a rare illumination is a good model. And again, just to remind everybody, we took this collection of faces under varying lighting conditions, and we applied PCA to them, and we were able to obtain the mean image as a mean face, and it really looked like a regular face. And then the first eigenface and the second eigenface, which demonstrated clearly what the variation of lighting conditions were. So one first eigenface might be light variation from left to right, and the second eigenface might be up and down. And so that was a good and appropriate model. So let me show you now a different experiment, which is done now under the assumption that in the previous example, all pictures were taken from the same pose, let's say a frontal face. So what we're going to do now is to take images of the same individual, and we're going to change the pose, and we're going to change the light at the same time. And so what you can see on the top is examples of the different poses, right? So there is a, you know, the left one, figure A, is the frontal pose. But you can see all the variations, right? And let's see now how the, we apply PCA to the same data, what happens. So as you can see, the mean image, by the way, actually this picture here illustrates a little bit what the poses are. So zero means frontal. And one means that the face is a little bit up, five means that the face is a little bit down, and then three means that it's a little bit to the left, and so on and so forth. So this is meant to describe a little bit the orientation of each one of the different poses. So look now what the mean face looks like. Right. So it's a little bit weird. You can see, for example, that the nose appears twice in different locations. And likewise, if you look at the first and the second eigenface, you can see all of these ghost effects as if multiple faces have been copied each other. And it's still the case that illumination is being captured, right? So this is clearly an illumination from this direction, and that's why the other side is in the shadow. But it's no longer providing what we had before, which was, you know, the mean face was a very sharp image that really represented sort of the average illumination condition. Here, perhaps if we look at the poses, ideally we would have liked something like pose 3 maybe to be the average, because it would describe the average pose as well as the average lighting. But that's not the case, and you get this superposition. And the reason being that we're using, again, the assumption of a linear subspace, and the mean is really the mean, and it results in the mean of the images. So if you have to average an image that is facing a little bit more up with an image that is facing a little bit more down, what you're going to get is exactly this superposition of two different things. And so what I hoped that this example would have convinced you is that the linear model is not always a good model. And in particular, in this example, if you're trying to model changes in the pose of the person, that has a non-linear effect in how the images look like. And the right thing to have done, perhaps, would have been that to average in the pose and orientation space and then produce the image, as opposed to averaging the images. And so what we're going to be trying to do right now is this question of how do we handle situations where the data set is nonlinear. Yet, there is still this idea that maybe a few principal components are sufficient. And so in particular, in this face example, we might be in the situation where I just move left to right. And if I only move left to right, there is just 1 degree of freedom, which is the angle of rotation. So while the number of pixels in the image might still be 10 to the 6, I should expect to have 1 degree of freedom. In fact, wouldn't it be cool that if I just gave you the images of just one individual, lighting doesn't change, and all what that face does is the following, right? And so you just go ahead and rotate 360 degrees. Perhaps I should expect that the principal components of that should describe a circle, right? And the one dimension would be exactly that I'm moving the circle, but I actually did an entire loop, so I should go back. And that's something that we cannot model with a single subspace. So how do we extend all of the techniques we have taught so far from the linear to the nonlinear case? Okay? So let me actually illustrate with pictures what's going on in this example. So I illustrated what the mean phase is and what the first and second eigenphases are in this case. But this is now doing the following. Let's plot the low dimensional coordinates, right? I've got the first principal component. Again, if I have n data points, that will produce n coordinates, right? And now let's plot the first principal component versus the second principal component. And therefore, I generate a two-dimensional vector associated with each image, right? And so what you can see here, and this is the first principal component, and this is the second principal component. What I've done is to color code each picture according to the pose of the individual. So you see four different colors. So when you look at this embedding, the first observation that I hope you can see is that the poses are all intermingled with each other. It's not the case that maybe all poses of, you know, frontal faces are all together. And maybe all 50-degree photographs are all together. They're all over the place. And still, in this data set that has four different poses and maybe 64 different lighting conditions, the main mode of variation is the light, right? So you can see in this particular case, the pictures at the top are the ones that have more light. The pictures at the center are the pictures that are darker with less light. And then when you look at the left, those are pictures that are illuminated from the right. And when you look at the things on the left, you see the lighting is exactly from the opposite direction. So still the two principal components somehow were dominated by lighting conditions, left to right in the x-axis, and whether there's a lot of lighting versus very limited lighting in the other. And the pose is all over the place. So how do we fix this? Okay. So what I'll be talking about is, just to show what would happen, is a technique called nonlinear extension of PCA that would allow us to produce something like this for the same data set. Where now, as you can see, all of the poses, five, now describe a they're all not identically together, but they're somewhat clustered in the same region of the low-dimensional embedding. And each pose has a different region. And it's approximately linear, in fact. Okay? So it's actually rather amazing that you can take this collection of pictures and just get two principal components and be able to get approximately this union of lines corresponding to the different groups. Okay? So effectively, this is almost showing that different poses correspond to different subspaces. At least this is an experiment, and this is really just two-dimensional, but this is suggesting, in fact, that if I just take the two principal components in a nonlinear way that I haven't discussed how it's done, I get a union of lines. The red is certainly quite a good line, the green, so is the cyan, maybe the blue is a little bit more spread out. And interestingly, if you zoom in, look, the lines all depart from the origin, roughly. This is zero, and this is zero. And so this picture here shows a zoomed-in version, and now things are intermingled. Okay. But in general, sort of the darker pictures went into the origin. So the question is, how do we do that? And so the idea is going to be the following. The idea is that we are going to take the data, x, and as we've been saying, typically we assume that the data lives in R capital D. And what we're going to do is that we're going to map it according to some embedding phi into phi of x. And this phi of x now is going to be, we're going to change the dimension. And the idea is that if I choose the dimension to be large enough, if M is large enough, then phi of x lies in a subspace. Okay. For those of you who have taken some class in mathematics, in particular, if you've taken a class in differential geometry or more broadly Riemannian geometry, you may be familiar with the Whitney's embedding theorem that says that if you have data that comes from a differentiable manifold of dimension little d, you can always embed it into an ambient space of dimension, I forget whether it's 2 times d or 2 times d plus 1. Right? So it can always be embedded into a Euclidean space by increasing the dimension. So that result from mathematics is a little bit what provides the idea here, that maybe we can make things linear by adding extra dimensions, effectively, and maybe applying some nonlinear transformation to the data. Now, clearly, you would expect that some cases that might be true. Maybe if I have some curve like this one, right? Clearly, there is a nonlinear transformation by which I can map into a line. And in that case, I can do it without changing the dimension. But if I have, for example, a different situation, like a circle, for example, there is no way, this is actually not possible, I cannot map a circle to a line, right, via a smooth transformation. And so this is a particular case where the only way to do it is that I need to augment the number of dimensions. And so the typical example is sort of as follows. I could have the equation of the circle be described as, or more broadly, maybe I've got ax squared plus bxy plus cy squared plus d is equal to 0. This is actually the general equation of a conic in the plane, right? And so this could be, for example, it could be an ellipse, just to give one concrete example. So the idea is the following. In this particular case, suppose that I take phi of x, y to be x squared, xy, and y squared. Okay? For a mysterious reason that it's not going to be clear to you right now, but it will be clearer later in the class time, if not on Friday, I will insert a square root of 2 over there. Okay. So if I do that, and I call this maybe z1, z2, and z3, right? If I do that nonlinear transformation, then this equation becomes a times z1 plus b, and so xy times square root of 2 is z2, so this is just b times z2 divided by square root of 2. And then I got y squared, so this is just c times z3, and then d. Okay? So this thing here is supposed to be a subset of R2. And that's the coin that I described here. And now, what I've done is this embedding, so this phi, in this particular case, went from R2 to R3. So in R3, what happened? What is this equation of?
Anyone can tell me?
It's a plane.
It's a plane, right? It's a plane. So now this is effectively a plane in R3. So that's exactly what I wanted to achieve. I've taken an ellipse, for example, in R2, and I've converted it into a plane in R3. And so that's the basic principle of nonlinear PCA. We're going to take this data as given to us. We're going to apply some nonlinear transformation to the data. And then we're going to assume that it's a linear subspace. And we're going to further assume that it's a linear subspace of small dimension. And we're going to apply PCA in the embedded space. Now, before I go ahead and write down how we do it, let me just show you pictorially the example that I just discussed. So this should be here. Here it is. Right. What I said is true, but keep always in mind that I'm cheating a little bit, okay? Because in this particular case, I started with that circle. Okay. I started with that circle, and I converted that circle into this plane, which is exactly the construction I just discussed. But in three coordinates, sure, I do have this plane, but still in the data is distributed in a particular way inside that plane. Okay. So still, I've got something that resembles a circle or an ellipse inside that plane. And so what we're going to do is that we're going to neglect that. And now we're going to do PCA, right? But here we couldn't do PCA, right? Because this, yeah, just think about it. This was a circle in R2. The dimension of it is 1, but if I want to model it as a plane, right, it is just the same as the ambient space, which is R2. Here, at least, now I've still got the circle. It's embedded into R3, but now there is a plane in R3. So this question of dimensionality reduction, it's impossible here. Here is a little bit silly because I'm just reducing from 3 to 2, but there is a little bit of dimensionality reduction going on. But the game is going to be that when the dimensions are large, so in this particular case, let's say that was images and the number of pixels was 1,000,000, maybe we are going to do an embedding into a space of dimension of 1,000,000,000. But inside that 1,000,000,000 dimensional space, I hope that the dimension is still much smaller. Okay? And that's what we're going to try. Okay. Okay. So let's just be silly for a moment. And let's just try to do PCA on this embedded space. Yes?
What is a proof or guarantee that the manifold N Rm space is always affine? Can I, or in that, put it in other words, can we always find an F this embedding which converts this nonlinear, this manifold in RD space to a an affine manifold in Rm space?
Okay. So, the answer to the question is going to be more evident when I describe the method in a little bit more detail. And so I'm going to give you the answer, but it might be a little bit incomprehensible without knowing the method. If you know what the method is, then you will understand what I'm saying. But by and large, the idea is going to be the following. We in machine learning are going to pick the embedding, and it's going to be fixed in practice. And we're going to have a battery of the typically and most commonly used 3, 4, 5, 6 embeddings that are used. In practice, those embeddings are not going to be exactly appropriate. And therefore, by mapping the input data into this feature space, we're not going to exactly make things fit. That being said, we're going to cover things in the class where there is a particular embedding
that is in fact the same that I just talked about, but generalized to many variables. We're going to call that the polynomial embedding that converts the data into all monomials to a certain degree. We're going to demonstrate that for a particular kind of nonlinearity that would be very important for the second part of the class, which is the data lies in multiple subspaces, that after applying this polynomial embedding, you do get a linear subspace out. And that's going to be exact for that particular case. But generally speaking, that won't be true. Okay? All right. So let's say I'm just happy to do that. And so I go ahead and I, you know, I have my initial data, and that's x1 through xn. And that's a matrix in R d by n, as same thing we've been doing so far. So what I'm going to do is now I'm going to define this new matrix phi that is effectively just applying the embedding to each one of the data. And now I've got my embedded data matrix, and this embedded data matrix is M by N. And so how do we apply PCA? We need to compute the mean of the data. So I'm going to define the mean as this vector phi bar. And we know what the mean should be. So it's 1 over n sum I of 1 to n of phi applied to each one of the data points. Right? Then what do? We first compute the mean. Then we center the data. So I'm going to define this matrix phi tilde, which is equal to effectively phi of x1 minus phi bar phi of xn minus phi bar. And usually we have written this as the entire matrix minus phi bar times the vector of all ones of dimension n. Okay, so we start with embedded data, we compute the embedded mean, we compute the embedded data matrix after centering it. So this. And now, in classical PCA, what we need to do is the SVD. So I will take this phi tilde, and I will compute using my transpose. And then the Y matrix will be equal to sigma V transpose. And that's how I find the principal components. And written, or sometimes we just say that this is the same thing as U transpose phi theta, right? The projection. The way to read this off is that you take the embedded data, you subtract the mean, and then you project onto the subspace. And that's what gives you the low dimensional coordinate. And that's how we did it. Okay. So far, so good? Now, the reality is, however, that this procedure, while clean and nice, might not be particularly practical. And so let me give one particular example. So let's say that I go ahead and I use this polynomial embedding, but let me generalize it to multiple variables. So let's say, for the sake of argument, that I had phi of x1, x2, xd now, and so I've got d variables, and I'm going to generate all monomials of a fixed degree. So this is going to be x1 to the d, x1 to the d minus 1, x2. Then, of course, there are many extra ones, so I can do d minus 1, xn. It should be x. I need to pick a degree, so let me pick degree little n. Then this, and then this should be d. Okay, so everything of degree n minus
1 in the first variable, but now I can take other combinations, right? X1 to the n minus 2, and maybe I'll have x2 squared, and then x1 to the n minus 2, and x2, x3, and I think you can keep going, right? Over all possible monomials of a fixed degree that can be generated, to end up that the last coordinate is going to be xd to the n. And the example that I described before was a particular case where I only had two variables, and therefore there are only three possibilities, x1 squared, going by that notation, x1, x2, and x2 squared, right? And I did it with degree 2, but I could have done it with degree 3, and then how many different ones would I generate in the case of degree 3? Well, x1 cubed, x1, x2, x1, x3, x2 squared, x2, x3, six, right? Six different ones. So in this particular case, the dimension m, which would be the number of all possible different monomials that I can generate, would be equal to d plus n minus 1, choose n. Okay. So let's see if I'm right. So this checking the particular cases that I talked about, d is equal to 2 and n is equal to 2 would be this case that I just described, right? So that would be 2 plus 2 is 4. No, probably it's not right. 2 plus 2 is 4, minus 1 is 3, choose 2, right? That would be 3 times 2 divided by 2 is 3. The next example that I just described was, so in this particular case, m is equal to 3, but now if the dimension is 2 and I choose degree 3, we just computed that it should be 6, right? So let's do it. So this is going to be 5 minus 1 is 4, choose 2, did I get it right? No, it's 2 plus 3 is 5, yeah. So it's 4 times 3 divided by 2. So that's 6. Okay. All right. But the bottom line being that not so funny. M is large, right? In fact, M, probably depending on, you know, if you keep D fixed, right, you could say this is O of d to the n, if capital D is fixed, if the dimension of the data is fixed and all the variables, the degree of the polynomial, you could say that is that, or you could say that is n to the d, if now if you pick the number or the degree to be fixed and you just vary the dimension. Okay. So it's sort of exponential on both the dimension as well as the degree. So the bottom line being that M is going to be gigantic. Remember, right, that the other way to think about this, I mean, I did it from the SVD here, but I could have said, or, you know, we compute this sigma phi matrix, right? We compute the covariance matrix, and the covariance matrix would have been effectively 1 over N phi tilde transpose, right, which is M by N matrix. Okay? So we can compute eigenvectors of that covariance matrix. And you can see, if M is huge, we're in trouble. So this calculation is nice and interesting, and you know, it's direct application of PCA in the embedded space, but computationally it's not very practical. And in fact, we will see on Friday that M might be infinity. In some cases, I might need to embed the data into an infinite dimensional space, that actually would be a Hilbert space. And in those cases, I can't even compute. So how do we make the calculation practical?
that's what we're going to discuss in the next other lecture today. How can we make the calculation part? So, going back to the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix type of calculation, and let me pretend for a moment that the data was centered to begin with. So, let me know, how can we compute PCA in embedded space efficiently, or at least more efficiently, right? So here's the basic idea. If the data was centered and we were to apply the covariance calculation, I would have like a covariance matrix up to scale that would be of that form. And what I want to do is to compute eigenvectors of that covariance matrix. That's what PCA was about. So by definition of eigenvectors, that's the equation defining the eigenvectors of that covariance matrix. Okay? So the idea is that, and here's is the important trick. The important trick is that the eigenvectors that I'm looking for, and in fact, we don't want all of the eigenvectors. We know a priori that we are interested in the eigenvectors corresponding to the largest eigenvalues. And we know that the covariance matrix is positive semi-definite. So we know that the eigenvalues are either strictly positive or zero, right? And in fact, and therefore we know for a fact that we want eigenvalues that are strictly larger than zero. We're going to look only for the largest. So if lambda is strictly positive, okay, then what we can do is the following. I'm going to write phi times phi transpose u divided by lambda is equal to u. Right? What I did was to just take the equation that I already had and divide by lambda, which is non-zero. So what this says, in fact, if I call this guy w, this says that phi times w is equal to u. Okay? In other words, the eigenvector that I'm looking for is always a linear combination of the columns of the embedded data matrix. So if the embedded data matrix does lie on some subspace, what this says is that the eigenvector that I'm looking for belongs to the subspace in embedded feature space. So written in word, this means that eigenvectors of embedded covariance matrix eigenvectors of the embedded covariance corresponding to non-zero eigenvalues are in the column span of that's what I just wrote. Now, this W vector is lambda inverse by definition. I just wrote it, phi transpose u. And so the norm of this vector, 2 squared, is w transpose w. This is u transpose phi transpose
U, and probably divided by lambda squared, right? Agree with that?
The norm of this vector of linear combination, the norm of the vector of coefficients that I'm looking for, has the following property.
Now, interestingly, here I've got that phi phi transpose U, and I also have here phi phi transpose U, and phi phi transpose U is equal to lambda U, so this is equal to U transpose lambda U and 1 over lambda squared, okay? And then U, typically, you know, by definition of eigenvector, we typically normalize it. So I'm assuming that the U has norm 1. So I get that this is equal to 1 over lambda. Okay. All right, so I just repeat where I'm going. The eigenvector I'm looking for is a linear combination of the columns of phi. And the vector of coefficients, instead of being unit norm, it has norm 1 over lambda, where lambda is the eigenvalue that I'm looking for. But here's the other important property. So this is property number 1. Property number 2. Suppose that I just take the definition of W, and suppose that I go ahead and try to compute the following. Suppose that I try to compute phi transpose phi times W. What do I get? Well, let's replace. So W, I know what it is because I've defined it as the equation on the top. So this is just phi transpose phi times W, but that is going to be lambda to the minus 1 phi transpose U. And so again, I have the same equation, phi, phi transpose U. Phi, phi transpose U. What is phi, phi transpose U? Is lambda times U. But I also have the lambda inverse. So all of this stuff here just becomes U. Right? So I get now that phi transpose times U. But what is phi transpose U? Again, from the equation at the very top, phi transpose U is going to be equal to lambda times W. So this is equal to lambda times W. So look what I got. What I got was that phi transpose phi times W is equal to lambda times W. Okay? Now, let's do a little bit of a counting exercise. I started with this matrix, and I was troubled computationally because this matrix was of what dimension? I wrote it probably there. That is M by M. Right? Like the phi matrix, where's my phi matrix, is at the top there. The phi matrix is M by N. So phi phi transpose is M by M. Right? So that was why I didn't want to do that. These eigenvectors are way too big. M can be large, M can be infinite. But here, what I have now is a different matrix, which is phi transpose phi. And if you look at phi transpose phi, what is the dimension of that? That's going to be n by n, right? In fact, this vector is a vector of dimension n. So this is n by 1. All right? And I can see that here also, from this equation, right, W needs to be of dimension little n, while U is of dimension, W is of dimension capital N, while U is of dimension capital M. So what this says is the following. All right, I'm going to start with maybe my images, and they're going to be of a million dimensions. I'm going to apply this nonlinear embedding, and I'm going to get a billion dimensions. But the number of images, in this particular, all of the examples I'm showing you has been a few hundred, maybe 1,000. Maybe we get to the image net dimension is 1,000,000. So all I'm saying is that n, in this particular case, could be significantly smaller than m. Okay? And so all what this says is sort of the following. It says, instead of computing eigenvectors of the covariance matrix, which is what I have here, I can compute eigenvectors. This is an eigenvector problem, right? So W is an eigenvector of this other matrix. The eigenvalue is actually the same. So if I solve this eigenvalue problem, I can get W. I know that the norm of W should not be 1, but should be 1 over lambda. But by solving this problem, I'm going to get W, I'm going to get lambda. Then I can normalize W so that it satisfies the property that the norm is 1 over lambda instead of 1. Because typically, when we solve eigenvector problems, we'll say that the norm of W is 1. But then I just normalize a posteriori. And once I'm done, I know that the eigenvector I was trying to compute is just equal to the embedded data times W. And the W, I computed it much more efficiently. Still, I haven't fully solved the problem because still, that phi matrix is quite large, okay? But at least I hope I convince you that I've gone sort of halfway, okay? And halfway, I mean, well, my goal is ultimately to compute y, and the way it was done over there, I need to do an SVD, an eigenvector of gigantic matrix, and then multiply times the phi. So everything is big. At least I have a way now to tell you that maybe this part, let's see, in fact, that this calculation reduces things. So, as a matter of definition, we're going to define this matrix K to be phi transpose phi. And this matrix is going to be called the kernel matrix. But let's see, can we use this in order to make our calculation way simpler than before? And again, my final goal is to compute y. And I'm assuming for the time being that the data was centered to simplify my life. So I know that the low dimensional coordinate that I want to compute should be u transpose times phi. Right? If the data was centered, that's the way I would compute. And I have a way of computing the eigenvectors right now, right? How would I compute the eigenvector? I already told you that the eigenvectors are here. They have the form phi times W, right? So I know that U is now equals to phi times W. Correct? And so if I just go ahead and substitute, what I get is U transpose, so I have W transpose times phi transpose times phi. Right? Right? I just substituted. U transpose is equal to W transpose phi transpose. But now, phi transpose phi is the kernel matrix. So let me just put this in a box here. So this is equal to W transpose K, which is the kernel matrix that I had over there. And now this kernel matrix is, as I said, n by n. So this is n by n. And the W, what is the W? The W is, each W has dimension capital N, and I'm going to compute multiple of them, as many as the number of principal components that I want, so little d of them. And so this W matrix in here, you know, this was supposed to be M by D, this was M by N, and this one is N by D. So this matrix is going to be little d by n, okay? So the final conclusion is, I don't need to compute the basis for the subspace. If my goal is to just do dimensionality reduction and find this low-dimensional embedding, all I need is the kernel matrix, which is of dimension little n by little n, okay? And these eigenvectors that I compute now are also of dimension n, so the complexity of this calculation depends exclusively on the number of data points, but not in any way on the dimension of the feature space m, okay? You're gonna say, sure, that makes sense, but still you've got to compute k, right? And to compute k, you have to compute phi and then take the dot product. So it's like, all right, I went step by step and things are getting better by the minute, but I'm not fully done yet, okay? So in other words, what this says is that if an oracle gave you the kernel matrix, which it's only applicable to the data points, then from the kernel matrix alone, you would compute its eigenvectors, and then from their eigenvectors, you would be able to get the low-dimensional representation, right? So the key question is, well, can I compute K without having to compute the embedding phi? So, yes?
So, is this quicker than computing the SVD of phi? It's because, anyways, you're not going to compute all the, singular values or singular vectors.
It depends on what the value of m is. If n is a billion, and n is 100 data points.
In that case, computing the first n singular vectors, is it quicker or?
Yeah, definitely. And in fact, I think I want to really put yourself into the actual case which you're going to be doing most of the time, which is the case where m would be infinity, and you cannot even compute eigenvectors of an infinite dimensional matrix. And so what this is telling you is that you can compute the eigenvectors of or even the singular vectors of an infinite dimensional matrix by computing the eigenvectors of a finite dimensional matrix, where the size of it is the number of data points. This is what this is telling you. And by the way, you can still do the same trick of saying, I don't need all of the eigenvectors of K, I only need as many as needed. So regardless, in fact, even if capital M was finite, the trick of I only need to compute one or two, why wouldn't I compute it here? If it is of dimension n versus m. Any other questions? Okay, so the final part then is, can I do everything out of K without ever computing phi? And so let's see if that's the case. So let's consider the example I've been using to motivate everything, which is this polynomial embedding. And let me do it first with the simplest polynomial embedding. So let me consider the example. Okay. And so I've got that phi of x, y, and I'm defining that way, is x squared, xy, square root of 2, and y squared. That's my definition. And now you're going to see why I need to put the square root into that. So what is the kernel, right? The kernel is, as you can see, is the dot product, right, between phi transpose and phi. But if I were to apply to just one data point, so the kernel in this particular case, maybe I should actually be using, let me actually change notation. So I'm going to use x1 and x2 from now on. And so this will be
x, 1 squared, square root of 2, x minus 2, and x2 squared. The reason being that if I look at that matrix K, right, it's really, as I said, phi transpose, phi, and this is a gigantic matrix, but it has lots of coordinates. So in particular, Kij is phi of the data point xi, and we should write the ball face xi transpose phi of xj, right? So each entry of that kernel matrix is the dot product between the embedding of two different points. Okay? So more broadly, what I'm going to say is that what I really care about is this function that takes one vector x and another vector y and computes the dot product between phi of x transpose phi of y. That's what I care. Right? Is that clear? So given any arbitrary two points, I need to compute the dot product of the embedded data points. That's what the kernel really is. So let's try to do that in this particular case where the phi mapping is exactly that. So in this particular case, this is going to be x1 squared. I'm going to try to do the notation that the curly and weird ones are the vectors and the non-curly ones are going to be the entries of the vector, okay? So this is x1 squared, square root of 2, x1, x2, and then x2 squared, dot product with y1 squared, y1, y2, and y2 squared. Okay? So you go ahead and compute the and you get x1 squared, y1 squared, plus, sorry, I forgot the square root of 2. Okay? So square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 2 times. And now I have x1, x2, y1, y2, and plus x2 squared, y2 squared. And now, if you think about it, this almost looks like something plus something squared, right? And so, in fact, if you think about it for a little bit, this is x1, y1 plus x2, y2 squared. Okay? Is that good? And look at what this is. This is nothing but take the dot product of the original vectors and square it. So, what that means, look at the magic thing that has happened here. Option number one is take your original data, embed it into a huge dimensional space. Take the dot product there. That's option number one. Okay? Option number two is don't do any embedding whatsoever. Just take your vectors as given to you, take the dot product before you get started, and then square the dot product or apply a nonlinearity to the dot product. And what this exercise shows for this very specific example is that the two of them give identically the same thing. So from a computational perspective, which one do I prefer? I prefer the latter one. So in fact, all what this says is that to compute the kernel matrix, all you need to do is to compute inner products of the original data and then apply a nonlinearity to it, which in this case is just compute the square of it. So I did it for this example, but this is also true more broadly for this embedding that I did here, except that I need to do a little bit of a correction, right? I did not put the square root of 2 or the exact scalings that are needed. But there is a particular scaling that needs to be put in each one of these entries so that you get exactly what's needed when you do
x plus y squared, or more generally, x plus y to the n. And what is that? There's a bunch of factorials that go when you do the multinomial expansion, is what I think is called in English, right? So you remember that it's like you have a multinomial expansion, more broadly, right? Suppose that you write a plus b plus c, or a, for example, to the n. Right, so you are going to get a to the n, you're going to get some coefficient times a to the n minus 1b, and so on and so forth. So all of these coefficients that go in there, more broadly, let me write this as follows. Maybe I shouldn't have done it with a, b's, and c's. Let me do it with a1 plus a2 plus a3, for example. So we're going to get a1 to the n, we're going to get a1 to the n minus 1, a2, and so on and so forth, right? And here, you get some particular coefficient, okay? So in general, what you really get here is a sum of a, n1, maybe I should say a1 to the n1, a2 to the n2, and in general, if I do it for d variables, I'm going to do ad to the nd, right? And there's going to be some coefficient that I put in front, which will depend on n1, n2, and nd, right? That's how this multinomial expansion will work out, okay? So what it's needed really to define the embedding is this phi map of a1 to ad should really be defined as this, the particular entry is going to be the square root of cn1, n2, nd times a1 to the n1, a2 to the n2, ad to the nd. Okay, so you compute all of the monomials, but you multiply them by the square root of the coefficients of the multinomial expansion. That's what you need. So in machine learning, this is known as the polynomial embedding, and the name comes because you're really taking polynomial functions of the input data to make up your nonlinearity. In algebraic geometry, this is known as the Veronese map. I think the history is that it's a mathematician from Verona, which is a city in Italy, and they don't know the name, so the guy from Verona. All right. But the important property is that this Veronese map, or this polynomial embedding, has the property that phi of x transpose phi y, so exactly the calculation I just did, is equal to x transpose y to the n. And this is now true for any, you know, for all x comma y belonging to Rd. So my little tiny teeny calculation that I just did for degree 2 and 2 variables can be extended to any number of variables in any degree. And the proof, what really goes behind, is just this multinomial expansion theorem that is sort of basic algebra. I mean, it's tedious and it will take you time, and maybe I'll give you as a homework, but you can probably do it as a freshman once you take this algebra class. It's just polynomial algebra, not too complicated. Okay, so I hope to have convinced you of the following fact, which just to summarize. You've got 2 points, you embed them into a huge dimensional space via generating all of the monomials of a fixed degree, and you take the dot products. That's alternative number one, that's what's written on the left. That is identically equivalent to just take the dot product right away and then raise it to the nth power. Okay, entry by entry. And so, the bottom line is, going back to the initial discussion, is that for this particular case of this particular kernel, I can can just evaluate the kernel. That's what this equation says. It says, evaluate the kernel for any pair of data points to generate a matrix K. What would be the implication of that is compute the dot products of your data and then raise every dot product to some degree. You choose arbitrarily. And that will give you a matrix K. Then it says compute the eigenvectors of that matrix K. That's going to give you W. Then it says normalize those eigenvectors so that they have norm. What was the norm? At the top there. The norm is supposed to be 1 over lambda. And then just the multiplication of W transpose with K, that would be, would give you the low dimensional embedding. So now I can go ahead and apply these two images. Because if I just give you now, let's say 1,000 images, each one of dimension a million, what would be the sequence of steps? It'll be compute the dot product between pairs of images. Right? There is 1,000 of them. So you'll do it for all pairs, so that'll give you 1,000 by 1,000 matrix. From then on, you just square it or compute the cube, whatever the thing you choose. Now you compute a few eigenvectors of 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, multiply, normalize, normalize, multiply, and now you get your two physical components. Right? While if you had done it via the actual computation of the embedding, right, it would have been a huge calculation. Because M would have been much bigger. Is that clear? So, just maybe to summarize the algorithm then, and I'll do that over here, in this particular case where the data is centered. So,
let me write this down.
So kernel PCA. By the way, this nonlinear PCA would have been what I wrote here. Embed the data and apply PCA to it. Kernel PCA is do that calculation, but do it with the kernel matrix instead of with the embedding. So the kernel PCA algorithm would be as follows. And I'm going to add the caveat here for centered data. Okay, so what we did was the following.
Yes.
Step number one. So given the input for the algorithm is the data, x1 through xn. So the first step is compute the kernel. So I need to compute every entry of the matrix Kij, which is just going to be evaluate the kernel at every pair of data points. Right? First of all, I go ahead and compute the kernel. Two, I need to compute K times Wi is equal to lambda I Wi. In other words, is I need to compute the eigenvectors of the kernel matrix. And I do this for I plus 1 to d. So I just need to compute the top d eigenvectors. Let me just insist that this is the top d. Okay. That's the second step. The third step is that I need to normalize. So how would I normalize? So what do I need to do exactly? I would like to ensure that I would like to produce, let's say, given W. So given W such that the norm of W is 1, which is what typically any algorithm would do. I need W tilde such that the norm of W tilde is equal to 1 over lambda, right?
norm squared was my calculation?
Yeah.
The norm squared is 1 over lambda.
Okay.
So what do I need to do?
So therefore, what I need to do is that W tilde is going to be 1 over square root of lambda times W. All
right? Okay, but you know, I sort of derived this step by step, but potentially, actually, what I'm going to do in step two is actually I'm going to maybe do an eigenvalue decomposition or something like that, right? Let's say I want to do all of them simultaneously, which is what we typically do, right? So in reality, what that means is that I'm going to go ahead and compute k is going to be equal to w lambda w inverse, I think, right? That would be the typical eigenvalue decomposition, correct? Is that right? Because then k times w needs to be equal to w times lambda. Yeah, that's correct. Okay. So typically, I would compute the eigenvalue decomposition. And then this calculation that I just did, what does it tell me? I need to compute w tilde. And the columns of it need to be rescaled. So rescaling the columns is equivalent to multiplying on the right by lambda to the minus 1/2. Each column of W needs to be divided by lambda, square root of lambda. So that's equivalent of saying the new W is equal to that. Okay. So if I want to do this in matrix form, that's exactly what I'm doing. I take the K matrix, I compute the eigenvalue decomposition, and then the result of it, that's good. And then step number four is to say that y is equal to, and I wrote it in my calculation over there, the final y is w transpose k. But the reality is that it needs to be w tilde transpose k, right? This is the normalized one, the one I need to use. And so the w tilde, I just have it there, would be w tilde transpose. So this is going to be lambda to the minus 1/2 w transpose. And now the w transpose multiplies k. By k is w. So if you wanted to replace that, but I don't know if that's going to be of any use. Maybe just like that. Just keep the k there. Since the k, in any case, I already put the k. Okay? But this is just to convey to you the extra modification, which is it's not just W transpose K, it's the W's need to be normalized. Okay? So that's why there is this division here by the square root of lambda. Okay? Is that clear? Yes.
What is the geometric intuition or interpretation of this other essentially, we are bypassing the embedding step defined in the AC that's that way.
Yeah.
So what does it geometrically mean?
I don't know if I have a good geometric intuition beyond what I've already said. So let me just repeat it, maybe with slightly different words. So there is a nonlinear manifold to start with. I apply a nonlinear embedding, and this becomes a low-dimensional subspace of a potentially infinite-dimensional space. In that infinite-dimensional space, there are eigenvectors that correspond to non-zero eigenvalues, all of the eigenvectors defining that subspace. And there are eigenvectors that correspond to zero eigenvalues. And if the ambient dimension is now infinity, there could be infinitely many zero eigenvalues. What this is saying is that the principle, the nonlinear principle components of the original data depend only on the eigenvectors corresponding to non-zero eigenvalues. And those are defined by the data, because the key thing is that equation. It says the eigenvectors u in the feature space are linear combinations of embedded data points. So even though in the embedded space you've got infinite dimensional things, the part that I care about from the perspective of getting the nonlinear principal component is spanned by the data only. And because it's spanned by the data only, I only need, I don't need all of the infinitely many extra dimensions that I generated. I just need those that are spanned by the data. And that's why the calculation can be done in dimension n as opposed to in dimension n. Okay. So at the end of the day, my intuition more than geometric is purely algebraic. Or exactly, I think that equation is the key. The eigenvectors I care about are in the span of the embedded data. Yes?
We inherently assume that the embedding is homogeneous. Is it possible to always have to center the data to choose our initial?
I will cover that in the next class. So in the next class, we'll do two things. One is, what if the data is not centered? And I'm going to demonstrate that you just take your kernel and center the kernel, and that's done by an algebraic manipulation that is very trivial. So everything goes through after you center the kernel. And the next thing that I'm going to do in the next lecture is, all right, I motivated everything just with the polynomial embedding that leads to this polynomial kernel. What about other type of nonlinear? So what I'm going to show in the next lecture is that you can give me a kernel, and as soon as it satisfies some properties, being symmetric and positive semidefinite, you give me the kernel, there exists an embedding associated to that kernel, always. And so you can always just do the calculations with the kernel. You know that it exists, but it's just in the back of your mind. And so that will allow us to, in fact, use other kernels. And in fact, the most commonly used is the Gaussian kernel. And for the Gaussian kernel, the corresponding embedding is infinite dimension. But that will come in the next lecture. All right, for once I did not finish too late. Thank you.